Hello everybody, welcome to Pinnacle Online Coaching Classes. I am Neeru and in this video lecture we are going to do a lecture on para jumbles. This is part 4 of the lecture. Pinnacle has made a complete series on para jumbles because this is an extremely important topic for SSC CGL Tier 2 exam. You will be given 20 questions from this topic, and if you know how to do them and if you know how to tackle these kind of questions, it's going to make a major improvement in your score. And in fact, this is a very scoring section where those students who know the tricks to do them, they can do all the questions correctly. There's an entire series of 20 video lectures to help you understand how these questions are to be approached, what is the right approach, and to understand how para jumbles of a single sentence and a paragraph are to be done. All these video lectures, they are part of our Job Assure Part 2 program. Job Assure Part 2, which is a specially designed scientific program for SSC CGL Tier 2. First, watch these video lectures, attempt all the questions given in the study material, and after that, 500 questions are uploaded on the test portal of our website. They're uploaded on the test portal of our website, and 500 questions on para jumbles and sentence rearrangement are there. Do them. This will give you a massive practice, and after that, attempt all the 40 tests of English which are being offered by Pinnacle, which all this is a part of our Job Assure Part 2 program. And in these 40 tests, in each test, you will have 20 questions to attempt on sentence rearrangements. All this 20 questions means total 800 questions, and here you have 500 questions here. This will give you massive practice because this is one topic which requires a massive practice. Now, having said all this, let me just give you a recap of what we did in part 1, 2 and 3. I did with you what exactly are para jumbles, and in part 2 and 3 I did in detail with you how to attempt para jumbles where you need to rearrange parts of a single sentence only. And now from part 4 onwards, we will move on to rearranging parts when a complete paragraph is given. Okay, so now let's start with rearrangement of a paragraph. Firstly, what is going to be the right approach? Understanding the right approach, what should I exactly do? Should I read the whole paragraph? When I am reading it, what should be there in my mind? What should I try to separate from the rest of the paragraph? All these kind of questions come to your mind. Now, what exactly is the right approach? What are you expected to do when you are reading the question for the first time? First and foremost, identify the chain of thought. What is the author, what is the writer trying to tell you? When you get the question in front of you, you have to read and understand the paragraph. I receive a lot of mails from students. They ask me whether I should see the options first or I should first read the question. A lot of questions like these are asked. In fact, even related to comprehension, I receive a lot of queries. Ma'am, should I read the questions first so that I know what am I exactly to look for in the comprehension, or should I read the comprehension first and then come to the questions? Plenty of questions like these. Very clearly here I am telling you today that in case of para jumbles or sentence rearrangement, read and not just read, even understand what is being tried to convey to you. Do not go to the options first. What will happen if you go to the options first? You are simply reading some four alphabets, RPSQ, QRSP. You are simply reading them. You are simply reading them, which will take up around 3 to 4 seconds, at least minimum. So go back and first read and understand the paragraph. Try to understand what is the author trying to say. Okay? Do not go to the options first without reading the whole question. Get an idea of what the author is trying to say. Why am I asking you to read the paragraph? Because now in the later slides, I'll tell you what is to be identified, what is to be separated, what is to be marked while reading the paragraph. Either you will have the first and the last part marked as first and last sentence, first and sixth in case of SSC, and you will have four sentences which are jumbled up, or maybe you don't even have the first part which has been set aside clearly. Okay, I will do that type also with you, although SSC rarely gives those types. I will even do those with you because we do not want to take a single chance. Even if you get the toughest kind for your exam, you should be able to attempt that. Now, understanding the right approach. I'll continue with this. Now, what exactly is the right approach? What exactly is the right approach? What are you to understand while you are reading the paragraph? Identify the three parts in the paragraph. There will be three parts in the paragraph, and what are they? First and foremost, identify the context. Okay, you have to identify the context. What is the context now? I'll explain that to you. You have to identify the main point of the paragraph. What is the main point? I'll tell you that also. Okay, and then you have to identify a central portion of the paragraph, which is known as details. See, you have to identify the context. What do I mean by the context? Context means what is the idea about which the author is talking. What is the idea? If he is describing a scene, what is he talking about? Is he talking about a bus accident? Is he talking about a fire? Is he talking about some kind of a celebration at home? You have to identify that. Identify the context. What is the author trying to say? Okay? What is being talked about in the paragraph? Once you identify that, then identify the main point in the paragraph. Now, suppose he is talking about Diwali, which is a celebration, and maybe in that he is trying to drive home the point that don't use crackers on Diwali, they cause pollution. Then that causing pollution, that is the main point in the paragraph. Don't use crackers, that is the main point in the paragraph. Suppose the passage is one related to social issues and it is talking about adulteration in food. Maybe the main point in such paragraph is that during festive season, adulteration chances are much more higher in sweets. Then that is the main point in the paragraph. Identify the idea, then identify the main point in the paragraph. It is going to be the main line of the paragraph. What is the author trying to put across? In the context, what is he talking about as a whole? And in the main point, what is he trying to put across? What is his message for us? Suppose there is a passage about accidents, okay? Suppose it's about a boat accident. A boat overturned in the water and many people were drowned. Now that is, the boat accident is being talked about. But maybe towards the end he tries to tell you that overloading and too many people in the boat were a cause for this. So overloading should not be done. That is the main line of the paragraph. Identify the context, identify the main point, and then there is going to be a central portion which will be all about details. Suppose a Diwali festival is being described in the passage. There will be many details about it. There will be details as to we wear nice clothes and we clean our houses and things like that. They are all known as details. Now, these details which are there, they could be supporting arguments, they could be a visual description, or they could be a time sequence. These are the three main ones, although apart from these, there could be some other ones also. Now, if I am talking about advantages of technology and the passage is a descriptive one which is in favor of technology, then there could be many points supporting what I'm trying to say. Technology will be my context, and to support that, there will be many points. If I'm talking about a visual, it's a paragraph about a visual description where a scene is being described. Suppose a sports day is being described, then in that there could be many things which you see around. They will be there as a part of the passage. You could have sentences like the race began and a child fell down. He stood up, but he finished the race and things like that. This is all visual description which we see. And then time sequence, when events are narrated, any small event is mentioned or a story is mentioned, in that the narration of the events, they will form a part of the central portion. These details which are there, they are a part of the central portion, and mostly you are expected to put these in order. You have to form a sequence of these. So what have I so far done with you in this presentation? First and foremost, read it. Read the parajumble well, okay? Once you read it, after that, try to separate these three points in that. What is the context? What is the main point? And what are the details? The details will comprise, or the details will make up the central portion. You have to do this. Now, let me just give you an example and try to do these for you. Now, here, example of context, main point and details. First, I will read it and then I will do for you. See here. You would have heard about it by now. Yes, Pluto is no longer considered a planet. For instance, Pluto is the only known heavenly body that rotates in synchrony with the orbit of its satellite. It is to be called a dwarf planet henceforth. So, unlike the other and our moon, Pluto and Charon continuously face each other. Even in the past, Pluto's status had remained shaky and was always considered a peculiar planet. Discovered in 1930 and named after the Roman god of the underworld, Pluto has an icy surface composed of nitrogen and methane and weighs just a fifth of the weight of our moon. Let me tell you that this is a previous year question. Now, in this series on para jumbles, I have included a lot of previous year's questions so that you exactly get an idea as to what does SSC ask. Now here, if you see this and this para jumble which is given to you, I would rate it as slightly towards the difficult side as in comparison to what SSC gives. Now if I ask you what is the context of the passage, what is the author talking about? The author is talking about Pluto. Very clearly, he's talking about Pluto. What is the main point in this? The main point in this is that Pluto, why Pluto is going to be called a dwarf planet. It will no more be a planet. It will be a dwarf planet. And all these points which have been given, they are arguing the case as to why Pluto will be called a dwarf planet and no more a planet. So these are the different points. Now, as I told you that when the case is being argued and the details which are there, they comprise the central section. So here we have the central section. You would have heard about it by now. Yes, Pluto is no longer considered a planet. So what is it considered? So it is going, what is it going to be considered if you are no more going to consider it a planet? Well, here is your answer. It is to be called dwarf planet henceforth, beginning with Q. You can see there is a link between these two. If you are not going to call it a planet, what will you call it? I will call it a dwarf planet. So beginning with Q, I have two options, option A and option C. Now here, if you see, this Q in option A, Q is to be followed by P. For instance, Pluto is the only heavenly body. Now, for instance cannot be used here because for before for instance something else needs to be there. So this is not fitting in. Now let me see QSPR. Q is going to be followed by S. Yes, we are saying that it is going to be called a dwarf planet henceforth. Even in the past, Pluto's status had remained shaky and was always considered a peculiar planet. So now the reference to the past and saying that even in the past, we were not sure whether we are supposed to call it a planet or not. And it was a very unclear situation. And why was it unclear? Because, for example, Pluto is the only heavenly body that rotates in synchrony with the orbit of its satellite. So S and then S followed by P and P followed by R. So unlike the Earth, which is a planet, and our moon, Pluto and Charon continuously face each other. So this C is going to be the right one. Identify the context, the main point and the details. I'll do another one with you so that you are comfortable in identifying these three parts. Let us see this one now. Nehru spent most of his childhood in studies. He rushed back to India and led an active political life, joining hands with Gandhi. His studies went on uninterrupted abroad until he received a call from India. He went to Cambridge to study, but now and then he could not help listening to political discussions in his house. Till the end of his career, he made Gandhi his political master. Now, this is my passage. Now, if I ask you, what is the context of the passage? What is being talked about here? Here we are talking about Pandit Nehru. We are talking about Pandit Nehru. And after that, if I ask you, what is the main point that the author is trying to tell us? The main point author is trying to tell us as to how Pandit Nehru came into politics. That is what he is trying to tell us. And all these things in between, these are the details. All these things in between are the details. Okay, now if you see this, this is also a previous year question as I just told you. Now Nehru spent most of his childhood in studies. Here you need to follow the time sequence. You need to follow the time sequence. In P, what is he saying? He rushed back to India and led an active political life, joining hands with Gandhi. And here he says, if you see, his studies went on uninterrupted abroad until he received a call from India. So first he will receive the call and then he is going to rush back. So here, if you see, Q is going to be followed by P. Q is going to be followed by P, and Q followed by P is here, Q followed by P is here. Here we do not have Q followed by P, here also we do not have Q followed by P. So these two options, C and D, get eliminated. And here we have but in the beginning. When but is there, it's a contrasting situation. A contrast is going to be shown. He was weak, but he won the contest. He was weak in English, but he improved a lot towards the end. So it's going to show a contrast. Now here, Nehru spent most of his childhood in studies, but now and then he could not help listening to political discussions in his house. This is going to be the first sentence, as it is connected to the one marked as one, the sentence marked as one. So one, then it's going to be S, and S I have here in the beginning. So S, but now and then he could not help listening to political discussions in his house. He went to Cambridge to study. This is going to be the next one. Then Q, his studies went on uninterrupted abroad until he received a call from India. He rushed back to India and led an active political life, joining hands with Gandhi. Till the end of his career, he made Gandhiji his political master. Absolutely right. Question number, this is the question, next one, which I was explaining with reference to context, details, etc. Now here, what is my answer for this one? My answer for this one is B. B is the correct answer. So I hope by now you can identify what is the main point, what is the context, and what is the details. Now, if I ask you, in what order are you supposed to put them? In most of the para jumbles that you get, firstly the context is going to be there, then the details will be there, and then the main point will be there. 60% of the para jumbles that you get in paragraphs, this is going to be the order. Sometimes the orders can also be jumbled up. Okay, it can be jumbled up, and the context will be first, and then the main points can be given, and later the detail can be given. This is also possible. This is also possible. This is going to be the order in approximately around 90% of the para jumbles that you are going to be given. 90%. Okay. And generally you will be asked to put in order the details. And to put the details in order, you need to know a lot of keywords. First, I will do the keywords with you. Okay, in this particular presentation, I'll do the keywords with you. In the next one, I will do with you a lot of exercise so that you know for which keywords to look for and how to put them in order. And after that, finally, I will move on to different kinds of paragraphs. I'll move on to story type, contrast type, social issues, environmental issues, descriptive and all that. And which exact keywords are to be applied in which one so that you can put them in order. And by doing all this, trust me, you will be able to score 100% marks in your para jumbles. Okay, now let us move on to the keywords. I hope you have understood what is context, what are details, what are main points. And now you have to gain a mastery of putting the details in order. Okay, now let us move on to the next one. This slide is extremely important. Each and every word on this slide should fit into your minds. Now, the details are also known as the central part of the para jumble. Okay, keywords to search the central part. Central part. Now, if it is a contrasting type of a passage, what is a contrasting type of a passage? Contrasting type of passage is going to be where a contrast has been shown. A contrast has been shown, that is going to be, and what is exactly a contrast? We can say industrialization is very important, it creates jobs, etc. But on the other hand, it creates pollution. That is a contrasting kind of a passage. We can talk about advantages of village life, but at the same time, there are no employment opportunities, there are no sources of recreation, etc. This is a contrasting type of a passage. And in such passages, you will have words like however, yet, but, still, nevertheless, in spite of, despite, on the other hand, rather, barring, on the contrary. Wherever you see these kind of words, you need to understand that now the tone of the passage is going to change. The tone of the passage is going to change. And after this, if we were talking about the positive prior to this, it will become negative. If you were talking about the negative, it will become positive. So try to locate these kind of words, and these kind of words will help you a lot to find the sentence prior to it or the sentence after this. Okay? These are the words for contrasting kind of passages. Similarly, in certain passages, a similar thought process has been elaborated upon. Like, for example, if I talk about morning walk, I say it is good for health, the air is fresh early in the morning, if you do deep breathing, your skin starts glowing, all these kind of things. Now here, there is not going to be any kind of a contrast. In fact, a similar thought process has been elaborated upon. If I talk about corruption, you know, first time I talk about that the citizens need to get aware, the citizens need to take action against it, and then I might just step on to, and the government also needs to make stricter laws and things like that. So in such passages, a similar thought process is being elaborated upon. And in such passages, you will find words like and, similarly, furthermore, in addition to, also, again, as well as, besides, likewise, moreover, similarly, consequently, to, etc. See, first and foremost, identify the three parts. What is the context? What are the details? And what is the main point? After that, try to look for these words and try to make out whether it is a contrasting kind of a passage or it is one related to similar thought process. Now, if I have a sentence beginning with and in my details, okay, I have one sentence that smoking causes cancer. And in another part of the sentence I have, and it is an expensive, dirty habit. Then the sentence beginning with and is obviously going to be going to be after the one causing cancer, because it begins with and connects two things, and will be there in the later sentence. So and, similarly, furthermore, in addition, also, again, as well as, besides, all these words, they are going to be in those sentences where a similar kind of a thought process is being talked about. There is no contrast in them. Okay. Then there are explanatory or descriptive kind of passages. Over there, you will have words like therefore, thus, so, because, since, for, instance, for example, above all, barring. These kind of words are going to be there. First, something is going to be told to you. Like, for example, you could be told, you could be talking about traffic jam. Suppose you're talking about traffic jam, we'll say that Delhi is a huge place, and then we will say that a lot of people own vehicles there. I often get late for office, therefore I must start an hour earlier for office. Okay, these kind of words will be there. They are going to explain something. And before them also, you need, if you see these kind of words in the beginning of the sentence or as a part of the sentence, you need to locate that sentence before them which they are trying to explain or to which they are related. Therefore, thus, so, because, since, for instance, for example, above all, barring, etc. These kind of words are for beginners. Beginners means they're going to start. First of all, to begin with, at the very beginning. At the very beginning. Then we have words to show time sequence, and these words are extremely important in story type. Extremely important in story type, or where advantages or disadvantages of something are being elaborated upon. Sometimes very clearly words like firstly, secondly, towards the end, at the end, these kind of words are given. They show the time sequence, they show the chronology in which the sentences have to be put in order. You could have for now, for the time being, after that, as he was reading, an insect crept into the room. In time, later on, meanwhile, next, when, then. Okay, he slapped him, then he decided to approach the police. Obviously, then he decided to approach the police will be after he slapped him. It very clearly gives you the time sequence. Soon, in the meantime, later, while, earlier, at the same time, simultaneously, firstly, secondly, thirdly, etc., etc. These kind of words will give you the time sequence. The time sequence will be given. If you see these kind of words, they will very clearly tell you that if suppose I have secondly in the passage, then definitely you have to look for the sentence which will talk about the first thing. So these are words related to time sequence. And then we have keywords for the concluding part. For the concluding part, the central portion, the details also have four parts. Afterwards, in the conclusion, in the concluding part, with this in mind, after all in all, in totality, as a whole, to sum up, all these kind of words. Now, suppose we are talking about the cleanliness drive in India. And the last sentence is that we have to make India clean by 2019, 2nd of October. Now, the last line, often if you are able to find the last line, it even gives you a very clear intro as to what is going to be the order. Our fifth line could be, to sum up, the citizens need to come forward and it is not just the responsibility of the government to clean India. This could be, and before that we could have talked of many things, that cleanliness drives are there in school, in government offices, bins need to be placed and things like that. So to sum up, it will give us the last part in the central portion. And then this point about questioning words. If you see these words, this, that, these or those, these are also important keywords. When you see them, you need to question what. Like for example, if you see this, as a result, if you see the sentence here, as a result, this leads to a lot of misunderstanding in the family. This is one of my parts. When you see this, you need to understand and ask, what is this referring to? Definitely, there is going to be another sentence in the jumbled part, which will be related to this sentence, and you need to pair this sentence with that part. Now, as a result of this, this leads to a lot of misunderstanding in the family. What is this referring to? This is referring to money. This is referring to household work. What is this referring to? Many of these species are found near the poles. These species, which species? Species of fishes, species of some kind of bear found there, species of some kind of penguin found there. What is this species referring to? If you see these, you need to ask this question and try to link it to another part in the para jumble which has been jumbled up, and then bring that part along with this part. And obviously that part is going to occur earlier and then it is going to be followed by this part. So these keywords will prove to be very, very, very beneficial. And trust me, you will be able to do the toughest para jumble if you know them and how to use them. Okay, now I have sorted them out for you, questioning words, concluding ones, and I have even done for you which are the ones to be used in time sequence, which are the ones to be used in explanatory ones, paragraph. I have done all of them here for you, and this is a complete exhaustive list. Beyond this, these keywords are enough for you to solve any para jumble. Now, once you locate the keywords, then what are you supposed to do with these keywords? Now, let's talk about that. Here we have what to do with the keywords. Once you have located the keywords, then what am I supposed to do with the keywords? Keywords will help you to form the right logical pairs in the sentence. Now, I have not used here right pairs, but I have used here right logical pairs. And as I have said in the very first presentation, that para jumbles is not about English. Para jumbles is, you can say, 40% about English, but it is 60% about logic, and it tests your reading with understanding. Okay, now here, once you locate the keywords, then try to form logical pairs with them. If you have located a keyword so, then you need to find a sentence before it and link the two sentences so that this sentence is being explained in the sentence which is formed with so. And what could be some logical pairs of the sentences? Some logical pairs could be like these. You need to couple the sentence with the noun along with the pronoun. You need to couple the sentence with the statement along with an example. You need to couple the sentence with the subject along with the introductory part. For example, my para jumble could begin with folk dances, and then we could move on to talking about a particular kind of folk dance. For an example, Garba. Okay, we could talk about the reforms in education, and we could talk about grading in examinations. So we need to couple the subject with the introductory part. We could also have two similar statements which are connected by and also in the similar way, etc. And I have done the similar thought, the keywords for similar thought process with you just now. We could even couple two opposite statements connected by but, on the contrary, in spite of, despite, etc. So what are we to do after we look at the keywords? After we look at the keywords, we need to form the right logical pairs. Form the right logical pairs and 60% of your work is done. Now let us move on to doing one parajumble with you so that you understand better. Now see, here we have, this is a previous year question. Now let us do it. See, it's a story type of a parajumble. Once upon a time, there lived a king by the name of Nanda. He adopted all possible tactics he could think of to bring her round but failed. Now here I have her. I need to question, what is her referring to? One day Varuchi's wife was sulking. As a last resort, he said, see, I have as a last resort here. So this could be among the concluding part, and among the concluding part generally we have the third or the fourth sentence. Because first and second are not the concluding part, it's the third and fourth which is the concluding part. As a result, he said, my darling, I will do anything to make you happy. He had a minister called Varuchi, an expert in politics. Here I have a pronoun, here also I have a pronoun. All right then, she replied, get your head shaved off and fall to my feet. Now here if you see, all right then has been used. Now what is then used for? Then is used for showing us time sequence. And when you are using then, definitely there is going to be a sentence prior to it, which will give us a hint that this has been done after that. If you see here, now once upon a time there lived a king. A king is my noun. I need to couple a noun with a pronoun. And beginning with pronouns, I have option P and option S. Now here I have P and here I have S. Let me try to fit in the option beginning with P. Q cannot be the first one because it says very clearly here, one day Varuchi's wife was sulking and Varuchi has not been mentioned anywhere. Now let anywhere prior to this sentence. Now here, once upon a time there lived a king by the name of Nanda, and I'm trying to fit in option P now. It says after that, option C, sorry, beginning with P, he adopted all possible tactics he could think of to bring her round. Now we do not know what is this her referring to. So this option gets eliminated. Next one. Now let us try to do A. Once upon a time there lived a king by the name of Nanda, and then S. He had a minister called Varuchi, an expert in politics. Absolutely fine. The king had a minister. Minister's name is Varuchi. Then Q, one day Varuchi's wife was sulking. Okay, fine. Then P, he adopted. Who is he here? Varuchi. Varuchi adopted all possible tactics he could think of to bring her round. And her is referring to what? Her is referring to his wife. Because it says here very clearly that one day Varuchi's wife was sulking. He adopted all possible tactics he could think of to bring her round, but he failed. And after that, R as a last resort. Obviously, this is going to be in the concluding part. So as a last resort, he said, my darling, I will do anything to make you happy. When he asks her, then she replies. So here is my time sequence word. All right, then she replied, get your head shaved off and fall to my feet. Absolutely right. Question number six, story type question as an example which I took. My answer here is going to be A. Answer here is going to be A. Now let me see why this is not the answer. Because a few students have even asked me, ma'am, please explain why this is not an answer. Now if you see here, once upon a time there lived a king by the name of Nanda. Then we have here S. He had a minister called Varuchi, an expert in politics. And then P. He adopted all possible tactics he could think of to bring her out. Again, we do not know who is her. So this cannot be the one. Always nouns will be before pronouns. So my answer is A. This was the last part of this video lecture of part 4. See, I have explained to you about keywords here, and just by mere explanation, you will not understand how to apply them. And I have just done one story with you here due to constraint of time, one example of para jumble here. In the next part, I will take up all kinds of paragraph. I will take one contrast type, I will take one descriptive type, I will take one time sequence type, I will take social issue type, etc. I'll take all kind of paragraphs, and then I will tell you which keyword to apply, how to apply, how to form the pair. And this will be done with done by me in part 5 of the para jumble. Get thorough with the keywords. They are the key to solve para jumbles. They're not just keywords. In fact, they're the key to solve the para jumble. Get thorough with them, and after that, apply them to your para jumbles. I'm sure you will be able to get a very good score. Trust me. Okay. Now, this question that was there, it was a little tricky because we had two pronouns here. But then I explained to you how to form the logical pairs. Okay. I wish you all the very, very best. Thank you. All the best.